A mother's frantic cry for help.
I just found myself running into the open hospital with my lifeless baby in my arms, screaming, "My baby's not breathing, help me, help me, my baby's not breathing."
But was it already too late?
That's when I knew we were in trouble.
On the next 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Well, welcome to 700 Club Interactive. Fans of the hit TV show The Voice are familiar with Brandon Chase. The country heartthrob joined Team Blake during season 5. He performed in front of millions and won their hearts along the way. Brandon's talent helped him get on the show, and an incredible miracle helped him survive infancy. His parents explain.
On the way to the doctor's office, Brandon was very, very lethargic, not responding, wasn't hungry, and it was past feeding time, wasn't crying. And about halfway on the ride, he really did begin to turn blue and very lifeless in my arms, very limp. And that's when I knew we were in trouble. He was born on a Saturday night. We were in the hospital all day Saturday, Sunday afternoon, they sent us home. And on Monday morning, when my mom went to change Brandon's diaper, there was blood in his diaper. And I knew it wasn't normal, but I wasn't extremely, extremely alarmed. But then the next diaper, there was a little more. So she told me we better call the doctor.
The doctor immediately sent them to the ER.
My mom looked at me and she said, "Don't put him in the car seat. You need to hold him. You need to make sure you try your best to keep him alert." And I said, "Well, he hasn't been alert in hours." And she said, "I know." She says, "Just blow in his face, pat on his cheeks." So all the way to the hospital, I did that. He did nothing. And about halfway on the ride, he really did begin to turn blue and very lifeless in my arms, very limp. And that's when I knew we were in trouble.
She called me while they were on the way to the hospital and I met them there.
I just found myself running into the open hospital with my lifeless baby in my arms, screaming, "My baby's not breathing, help me, my baby's not breathing." There was this lady that just appeared to the left side of me, and she said, "Honey, let me help you." And she took Brandon, and the next thing I know, she's literally pushing in on his chest and doing different things. She radioed ahead. People came and joined her, doctors, nurses.
That nurse was the first miracle, because she was the head of the neonatal intensive care, so she knew exactly where to take him, what to do.
They laid him on a hospital bed, put a needle in about this size, and Brandon didn't even flinch. They put that in the back as like a spinal tap type thing, I guess. No reaction whatsoever, not even a reflex. About that time is when Brian arrived at the hospital, and I remember telling him, "He's gone, our baby's gone. We've lost our baby."
The doctors ran extensive tests on Brandon for 12 long hours.
They needed to test all of his vitals. They needed to test his breathing, his heart. And then after that time period is when they came back and they said, "Brandon quit breathing 64 times in the 12-hour time period. We're not sure what's going on, but there's something going on here." And I remember my dad crying and hugging me, and he said, "We're gonna pray, we're gonna believe, and God is gonna heal him."
Brandon stayed in intensive care for several days. The doctors didn't know what was wrong or what to do.
We couldn't hold him, we couldn't touch him. Just, he was with wires and in a big incubator and lights and everything, and he just laying there, and he still seemed very lifeless to me the first couple of times that we saw him. I wanted him to know who we were. I wanted him to recognize my voice if he couldn't recognize my touch. So I remember speaking to him, and I kept telling him, "Brandon, fight, fight. You gotta be my little fighter. You're gonna make it." It was about the third day, she finally let me hold him. I sat in that rocking chair and I sang to him as much as I could and loved on him and just reminded him how much we loved him and how much we were praying and that God was gonna heal him. The doctors never really could pinpoint and give us a name for what had happened or any real explanation, but they felt like we should expect, at the least, slow developmental skills. And they said time would only tell whether or not he was gonna be normal brain-wise, just because he had lost oxygen and quit breathing so many times.
It was a terrible feeling knowing, you know, that he could be handicapped, mentally ill, that we just stood on God's word.
Once I knew God allowed him to live, we trusted, we believed, and we just declared that he was going to be normal in every way. After about a week being in the hospital with Brandon, we were finally released to take him home. But we went home with heart monitors and a breathing machine. And they stated that that would probably last for at least 2 years of his life, especially for the first year. Just learning how to put those leads on every night in the right place, I remember, was very tedious. And then you'd get him all settled and get him, we'd go to bed. And I remember those leads would go off and you'd jump up out of your skin thinking he's quit breathing. And we had to have him on those machines for the first couple of weeks, every day, all day long. Only could take him off to bathe him. Then we went back to the doctor for a couple of weeks checkup. And they told us we could kind of taper down and only have him on when he was asleep. We came up on Labor Day weekend and my dad called and he wanted us to come home for the weekend.
Karen and Brian didn't want to make the 2.5 hour trip with Brandon with all of his medical gear, but her father persisted.
And we went and we spent the weekend with my dad and he watched each night as we would have to put all the leads on and the wires and the machines and lay him in the crib and let him just fall asleep. And tore my dad up, came back home. A few days after we got home, my dad called me. He said, I want you to take Brandon back to the doctor. God is healing your baby, and he's going to come off of all that stuff.
The doctors ran more tests, and Brandon seemed fine. The readouts gave him a clean bill of health.
Continued to pray about it, and we took him off of everything. And Brandon's never been on those machines again.
Looking back, he was just a total miracle.
I want them to look at Brandon's story and believe that if God can heal Brandon, God can heal their child too. And never believe the doctor's report. But if you stand up and you declare, God is my strength and God is the healer, God will meet you at the point of your needs and he will heal your child and he will be with you and walk this path with you.
As we just saw, from a young age, Brandon knew that God saved him for a purpose. And now, as a singer, he's trying to make a difference. Take a look.
I didn't really start my love and passion for music until I was about 14. Before then, my life was baseball. That's really all I focused on. I want to be a professional baseball player, and that's kind of what I have my sights set on. Through interning at my church and just serving and being a part of youth ministry, an opportunity came up to be a part of the youth worship team. I had no background in music, but I felt like the Lord was saying, this is designed for you. From that moment on, I just fell in love with music, and it's just been so cool to see all the doors that have opened up since then. I grew up in a Christian home and grew up going to church, but you know, there comes a point in your life you have to make your own decision. You have to make your own relationship with God. You can't live through your parents or through your family. At summer camp, when the Lord touched me, you know, I just remember just feeling like, wow, this is what it really means to be a Christian. This is what it means to have a relationship with God. I was playing in front of a couple thousand three nights a week. It was fun. It was cool. I learned a lot. I grew as a performer. But at the same time, I just felt like I was kind of stuck. I got an email from The Voice inviting me to a private audition. We prayed about it. We just really felt like it was what I was supposed to do and just kind of went after it without any expectations. Made a spot on Team Blake. CeeLo also turned his chair. I didn't win the show and I didn't expect to win. I just kind of knew I was supposed to be there for a certain amount of time. There was definitely some performers that, you know, I got to spend a ton of time with because we were all together for extended periods of time, not able to go anywhere except across the street to get food. And so we were all just kind of trapped in this hotel environment for really a couple months. And you really got to know people one-on-one. There were several believers on my season. And we did have some Bible studies once a week. And that was just really cool to be able to just come together, encourage one another. And, you know, I feel like just me being myself and just being positive and being able to speak into people's lives during that time, I really feel like I was able to make a difference. I think it's super important for Christians to be involved in all that's going on in the media. We look to those people that we see and that we hear on our radio. We look to them and our young people are led by those people. They look up to them. Media is influence, and and you have to have influence to reach people. To me, I just think it's so pivotal to be in a position of influence and to be in a position of leadership where you can reach and affect people. How great of an influence and impact can you make being in the spotlight? And when that spotlight is on you, to be able to then say, listen, I know I'm in this position, but I'm only in this position for one reason, and that is to, you know, bring glory to God, and that's because of God I'm in this place. Then you're making a difference. And so I hope that He uses me for that. I never set limits, you know, so I always just say, you know, whatever you want me to do, Lord, I'm gonna do it. However far you want me to go, I'll go, and I'll just be content and happy with where you have me.
Well, Brandon's songs are certainly lighting up iTunes. His single One was on its new and noteworthy chart, and it's available for download on all digital platforms. Still to come, a singer loses her most prized possession.
Great. Same God that took my mother, now you take my voice. You take my mom, you take my voice. What good are you?
Hear how she lip-synced her way to a miracle. Up next. Deanna Ransom had a great family and a great voice. At the age of 5, she combined the two. But by the time she was an adult, Deanna lost them both.
The pain I'd endured had engulfed me.
For as long as she can remember, Deanna Ransom loved to sing.
There's something about singing from your soul and just opening your mouth and being able to just cry out, so to speak. And that's what singing does for me.
She grew up in a Christian home and sang in her family's gospel group. She didn't have a personal relationship with Christ, but she learned about Him from her mother.
My mother was the bedrock of the family, the real matriarch, and she was what we would call a warrior for God.
But when Deanna turned 21, her mother died.
I felt lost and cheated. I got very, very angry with God because I felt as though He should have spared her.
She left her church and her singing group and moved to Atlanta to pursue a career in R&B music. But over time, she started losing her voice.
Couldn't talk above a whisper. Rasping, choking, trying to swallow was like razor blades.
She went to a doctor and discovered she had nodules or cysts on her throat. The doctor told Deanna she would never sing again.
And I remember sitting in the doctor's office and feeling so numb. Like, great, same God that took my mother, now you take my voice. You take my mom, you take my voice. What good are you?
For 2 years, she wanted nothing to do with God. With her music career gone, she felt empty and without direction. That is, until one day when a friend invited her to church.
It was like waking up after falling asleep, and you didn't even know you were asleep. Something woke up and said, you need to go this time. No excuses.
After the sermon, the pastor gave Deanna a personal message.
And he said, God said there is a reason and a purpose for that gift that He is giving you. You know, what changed for me was He cared enough about me to get word to me. Even though I had walked away from Him, it kind of showed me He never left me. And even though, you know, you hear folks say all the time, you don't get angry with God. I was angry. And I would have thought that that was grounds for death. But He loved me and was understanding enough to say, yeah, I know you're mad, but it's okay. at that moment, I said, yes. Here I am, God. Here I am. Use me. I'm yours. And I just surrendered.
Deanna gave her life to Christ. She joined the church, and even though she couldn't sing, she rejoined her family gospel group, and she lip-synced the words.
It was an act of obedience to be up and just in position to say, okay, if this is what you want to use, I don't know how you're going to do it, but I'm here.
Still, she believed God would restore her voice, and one night at a concert, it happened.
My voice just came back in front of the whole church, and the church was packed out. There was over 500 folks in that church. I didn't stop singing. Because I was standing there just like, is this real? Everyone just blessed God, and it was amazing to see so many people rejoicing for what God was doing. Little old me who had walked away from him.
Deanna went back to the doctor. This time, she got a different report.
Your vocal cords are completely clean. I need you to know I'm a man of medicine, not miracles. And he is the family doctor. He says, but baby girl, that's a miracle because they're just gone. They didn't shrink. They didn't get smaller. They're just gone.
Deanna says she knew God had healed her.
I was in awe, just in awe. His hand was on my life and it was good.
Lord, I hear your voice.
Deanna went on to pursue her dreams. She recently released a new album. And she says her relationship with Christ is better than it has ever been.
He showed me that I am a divine healer. And don't you ever forget who I am and what I can do. He invited me to get to know him. I had to throw out a lot of what I thought God was so I could get to know who he is. God says, you tried me. You get to know me. I want a relationship with you.
And he wants a relationship with you. The Bible says, taste and see that the Lord is good. So often we have God as some kind of abstract concept, you know, that he's far away, that he's not concerned. You know, if God were here, why are all these bad things happening to me? And we forget to read the stories of the Bible that are there to let us know he's still there. In the midst of any difficulty, he's still there. And he's the one, the only one, who can deliver you, who can save you, who can heal you. He's the one. But for whenever we get into difficulty, we start complaining. And we start saying, God, you're not running the universe right for me right now. Things should be easy for me. Things should be this way. They shouldn't be the other way. Not realizing that God is actively shaping all things together for our good. That the difficult moments are the moments that try our faith. The difficult moments are when we come to the realization of who he really is and how he's always been there and his righteous right hand has been holding us the whole time. Here's a Bible verse for you. I hope you can memorize it. When we are faithless, he remains faithful. He cannot deny himself. And regardless of what you've done, regardless of your rebellion, whether you were like Deanna, you ran away, you got angry at God, first you took my mother, now you've taken my voice. Where are you? Why aren't you answering my prayer? What is all of this? At the end of all of that, she came to herself and she came to a realization that God is real and He wants to be the supplier of every need. And when she cried out to Him, when she turned and came back to Him, that's when the restoration happened, and that's when the healing happened. Not some little thing, not some reduction, but it got completely taken away. The same thing can happen for you. It's when you're at the end of the rope that you find out He is real. If you want to know Him, if you want to have this experience, here's a simple prayer for you. Jesus, if you're real, if you really are there, could you show me? It's that simple. If you pray that with all of your heart, He'll show up. He'll manifest Himself to you because that's what the Bible promises. If you want someone to pray with you, to agree with you in prayer, we're here for you. It's a toll-free call. All you have to do is pick up a phone. 888-777-1999. Still ahead, just in time for Christmas.
Tells you about the characters, the artifacts, the games are awesome.
Something new and exciting from Superbook when we come back. Superbook is bringing the stories of the Bible to the children of the world, one family at a time. You're about to meet a family that's creating their own Superbook legacy. Matt Olson and his six brothers were raised with the original Superbook series, and now a new generation of Olsons is following in their footsteps and beyond.
Grandma Olson knows how to throw a fun party for her grandkids. Pop a little popcorn and play an episode of Superbook.
Here we go.
I get really excited to come over and watch Superbook.
It is so good to have you home.
I see my grandchildren smiling and laughing, totally involved with the stories.
Yeah, it makes the Bible come alive, like I can really feel it. Like, oh, what's next, what's next? And I just want to learn a lot.
You can look up what Superbook movie you're going to be watching. You can just open it and follow along. It'll be exactly true with the Bible.
That's something Grandma Olson's son Matt loves about Superbook. He and his six brothers were raised on the original series.
Studying the Bible myself, I see things on the screen. I'm like, hey, that is in the Bible. And they're actually accurately portraying the stories and some of the even the minute details of what go into these stories. And it really gets my kids interested, and I love it.
Today, Matt's kids have a tool he never had, the free Superbook app.
It's just amazing. It tells you about the characters, the artifacts, the games are awesome. It's just an awesome place to go to on the phone.
I love the Superbook app because you can go on there anytime you want to. If you're feeling afraid or something's going on.
There's so much darkness in the videos and some of the things that the kids watch these days, and so much violence and immorality. You have something like Superbook that brings light, that would counterbalance this darkness that has come into their life. I'm very thrilled that that legacy is being passed down to the grandkids.
And Grandma Olson's glad her partnership with CBN is bringing Superbook and the stories of the Bible to the children of the world.
Seems to be accepted with all governments, even those that you think would not accept it, they're accepting Superbook. And this will bring a lot of kids into the kingdom, seeing these stories when they're little. Plus, it'll help them when they're older. They'll remember these things that they learned, where they can trust their Heavenly Father to take care of them, to lead them.
Just one question.
Do you know when they're gonna make their next Superbook movie?
The next one's gonna come out in about a month. Right now, we have something for you that if you are looking for Christmas gifts for children, for grandchildren, for friends, neighbors, we've got a complete package for you. We have the story of the birth of John the Baptist. And if you join the Superbook DVD Club, you won't just get one copy, you'll get three DVDs. And then as an extra bonus, we'll give you three DVDs of the first Christmas, the story of the birth of Jesus. If you want it, order right now to get it in time for Christmas. 888-777-1999. We leave you this word from Psalms. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. With my mouth, I will make known all your faithfulness to all generations.